This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
See Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you by AML Foods Limited, Burger King, the Cleveland Clinic, the Digital Transformation Unit, Freeport News, RF Bank and Trust, and Royal Star Assurance.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful. It's a beautiful day. All God's days are beautiful, but boy, listen to this weather. Where I am here in Freeport ain't looking too good. Look like Hurricane Adelia. Must be having some out of bounds impact us or something, because it's gotten pretty ugly. I mean, it's getting ugly. So I hope we hold up. That's all I can tell you, right? Well, welcome to 96.9 FM Guardian Radio. If you want to give us a call today on the show, the numbers to do so are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We are live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. Yeah, it was reasonably clear earlier today, and then she started to get very dark and windy. And so anyway, we hope for the best for everybody, including the people on the west coast of Florida, where the hurricane is expected to make landfall. Listening to some of the reports took me back to some of those very difficult stormy days we had in this country, affecting Grand Bahama and Abaco in the instance of Dorian, and then Grand Bahama with Francis and Jane, and it's something. And I hope you guys are readying yourselves, preparing yourselves for the hurricane, for in case there is a hurricane. We pray there is not, but you never know. We are not in control of these things. And so take care of yourself. And the best time to do that is before a storm comes, right? Because once the storm is here, it becomes more difficult. Entirely more difficult to do that. All right. Well, I want to talk to you about a couple of things today. And hope you might want to weigh in on it if you feel so inclined. First thing I want to talk about it. I hear lots of people talk about Grand Bahama. Lots of people. People in Grand Bahama talk about Grand Bahama. People outside of Grand Bahama talk about Grand Bahama. And what's wrong with Grand Bahama? What is required to fix Grand Bahama? How long what's been wrong with Grand Bahama is required to be, what has been going on. And, people talk about the extension of the Hawksbill Creek Agreement. And honestly, far too often, the discussion is without real knowledge. That's reality. I mean, it's really not grounded in knowledge, in facts, or an understanding of what is happening. To his credit, I have to say, I've listened to see Alan Johnson on occasion weigh in on some of these discussions. And see Alan Johnson seems to have more grounding in the realities of what has happened in Grand Bahama, even economically speaking, than many of people I've listened to seem to have. And to his credit, I have to say that. So I wanted to talk about Grand Bahama for a moment, for some time actually, and see if we can't ground some of the realities of Grand Bahama in facts, in logic and reasoning. I was actually asked by someone who was preparing a report. They said to me that, you know, this row between the government and Grand Bahama Port Authority. So where do you fall on that row? Because people are saying, well, the Port Authority hasn't done this and the Port Authority hasn't done that. And the government is saying that, you know, it's taking over the responsibilities of the Port Authority and so forth and so forth. And so I weighed in on it a bit, but let's see if we can start here with Grand Bahama. Start here. Firstly, let me say, I truly believe that the Grand Bahama holds perhaps the best and the quickest opportunity for an economic expansion and social relief for the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Let me say it again. Grand Bahama, with Freeport, the city of Freeport at its core, holds the best hope for the expansive economic growth of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas and for social relief of it. Why do I say that? This island has about 50,000 people. It is highly underpopulated. Its infrastructure, particularly in the city of Freeport, has enormous capacity to host five times that number of people to host it. It has the ability to host multiple billions of dollars in capital investment in economic enterprises. And if it realizes even a margin of the potential it now holds, it creates opportunities for a flow of people back from New Providence to Grand Bahama, and some additional people who might see Grand Bahama as new opportunity for themselves, therefore providing some social relief to the capital city of Nassau. And it has this potential. Now, we'll talk about what stifles that potential maybe in a bit, but let's start with that. That the Freeport cannot be seen as a political football, right? It should not be seen as a seat-grabbing opportunity. In the grander scheme of things, Freeport ought to be seen as an immense opportunity to press forward the prosperity and economic stability and fiscal relief of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And that's why the urgency of trying to help it realize its potential is that much more stark. Now, some of you, when you comment on Freeport and Grand Bahama, love to do so from a political point of view. it becomes a question of no party ever did, and no party did this, and no party did that. And it is just sheer ignorance to do so. It is. It's not knowing to do so. Freeport has had, under the Pinling era, significant periods of economic prosperity, hence coming into this notion of being the magic city, right? And so that was how so many people from Nassau found their way to Freeport, trying to get opportunity. So in the Pinling era, there were periods where Freeport thrived. Might I remind you that Sir Lyndon Pinling and his team were politicians? They were a government of the Bahamas, right? In the 90s, beginning in 1993, continuing on to 2000, Freeport's economy was booming. I don't have to speak about that because I read about it. I lived it, lived in it, was around for it, right? It was a period of time where Freeport's unemployment rate fell to as low as 6.7 or 6.9%, right? People in Freeport had 2 and 3 and 4 jobs. Freeport's economy was so robust, the cement people here in Freeport could not export cement to Nassau because they were using it all up here in Grand Bahama. And might I remind you, the 90s was the Ingram administration era. Politicians, can I remind you of that? Right. So when you are commenting on the realities of a place, at least be armed with the facts. Try not to be bogged down in the nowness of your scope. Try to at least survey the place, because that's the only way to do a proper analysis that might allow for a more accurate assessment of what in fact is happening on in the place. So might I also remind that in the periods where Freeport was booming under, say, Sir Lyndon, under, say, Ingram, and those are the only periods it had any sustained economic growth, the Grand Bahama Port Authority was the Grand Bahama Port Authority, was still the licensee, was still the licensing authority in Freeport, and it still had the Hawkesville Creek Agreement. Under both periods, the Hawkesville Creek Agreement was still in place. Still in place. Right? So there were still politicians involved, as in the government of the Bahamas, in one instance a PLP government, and in the other instance the FNM government, and the Grand Bahama Port Authority was still the Grand Bahama Port Authority. And the Hawkesville Creek Agreement was still intact. So, it is not accurate to suggest that Grand Bahama or Freeport has never seen or never known any sustained period of prosperity or economic growth or development under any administration or under the Grand Bahama Port Authority. It is absolutely untrue. And might I add, listening to me today, any number of people from Grand Bahama, including my mother, who was a straw vendor for many years in Grand Bahama and was a cook for years, any number of them listening to me today could tell you they lived the experience of the better times in Grand Bahama, not listening to me talk about it from an economic point of view. They lived it. They cared for their children and family, built their homes and duplexes and businesses in this same Grand Bahama that some people talk about as if it never enjoyed prosperity. It did. It did. It did. Now, granted, those sustained periods of growth, as for example, on the Selenium, which would have been more mid, from the mid 60s to maybe the late 70s. There was prosperity in the early 80s and admittedly buoyed some by the narcotics trade. Don't miss that. Buoyed by the narcotics trade, and in the mid 80s when that clampdown came on that trade and that all the tension of the world came on the Bahamas as a paradise lost with all of the gleams of corruption and drug trafficking, that stymied some of that narcotic economy that was buoying Freeport, and so Freeport stagnated, as did much of the Bahamas, into the early 90s. So by 1990, 1991, the Bahamas was an economic disaster. The unemployment rate in Grand Bahama was of the order of 14.8% or so, close to 14%, the highest it had been in a generation. The government of the Bahamas was in the doldrums when it came to its fiscal affairs. The government of the Bahamas sought to float $100 million worth of bonds and could get only about $25 million in subscription at the time. That was how bad things were. And then there was an election in August of 1992. And Hubert Alexander Ingram became Prime Minister of the Bahamas. And in that period of time, the Atlantis came on stream. And for Grand Bahama, working with the Port Authority, a host of new investments came on stream. The new hotel, Alucaya, after the implosion of the Atlantic Beach Hotel and the container port and Bradford Marine and the shipyard and a host of other things happened, and the place was rocking and rolling so much so people were making money and building apartment complexes like crazy, and there's apartments still here today. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Yeah, man, how you doing, Laing?
Hey, I'm right here, man. What's up?
All right, you know, but I think, you know, we need to get back to the intention of Freeport, you know, starting out, you know, Freeport had really nothing to do like with Bahamians, you know. T-55, you know, the sun was setting on the empire. And the British government seek to establish an outpost off the east coast of America, okay? Freeport was supposed to be something that was far more substantial in terms of, you know, everything, every industry that was in America was supposed to be in Freeport, okay? Now, I think we need to get back to the envision of what Freeport was supposed to be, and probably use the exercise as a template for the ongoing development of all islands.
Freeport was the vision of Wallace Groves, and Wallace Groves' vision for Freeport was templated on Fort Lauderdale.
Yes, yes.
And they had initially wanted to call the place Marco City, not Freeport.
Yes. Okay.
So it was really supposed to be another kind of playground for the wealthy, like Fort Lauderdale was, and so forth. And yes, there was a belief that it could have an industrial center. Also,
no, no, the the industrial intent of Freeport was well established in the early days. In terms of, you know, if we look at the history of what came there, you know, because, you know, it's those industries that brought the Bahamians from all over to Freeport. Now,
yeah.
In its present state, you know, I dare say that all the Bahamians in Freeport now are just caretakers, right?
No, that's not true at all.
Like, in terms of the potential of Freeport,
All right. Let me you have to finish up for me, please, and then I let me move on to this continue this narrative that I don't want to confuse people.
Okay. I'll call you back.
Okay. Thanks. Yeah. All right. So we were speaking more of Freeport's more recent history and what has been happening in Freeport, and as I was saying before, with the with all of the Bradford Marine and Grandmama Shipyard and the then Alukaya and the container, it was a booming place, booming from 1993 to 2000. And then, like the rest of the Bahamas, the events of September 11 slowed things down. And shortly after the September 11, Francis and Jean back-to-back hurricanes came and took out nearly 300 businesses in Freeport, many of which have not returned to this day, including the Princess Hotel, which was a significant employer of people. Its payroll was of the order of $30 million a year. And with a $30 million a year payroll and looking at an economic multiplier of three, that would have been supplying Freeport with almost $100 million annually extracted out of that economy and creating a huge vacuum. And then it had the death of Edward St. George, who the thought of him was a mover. He was a person who was focused upon understanding quite significantly what was necessary in the way of attracting businesses to Freeport. He understood you don't move the economy if new businesses are not coming and investing and setting up in Freeport, and that was why he and Laing worked so well, try to attract new businesses to the place. And with his death and the departure of, say, like the likes of an Albert Miller, that development-minded thrust of the Grand Bahama Port Authority has never been the same. Never been the same. And so since that time, there has been only marginal significant investments in Freeport. And I wouldn't even shout for the rest of Grand Bahama saving, except for what's happening now, perhaps with Carnival. And so for almost 20 plus years, for some 20 plus years, Freeport has been a limping economy. Limping. No significant new investments to absorb employment, unemployment to create new employment. None. Not at all. Not at all. You've been living in Grand Bahama for 20 years. Go east, go west, and then come to Freeport and just name it. Name the significant investment. Name it. Name one. One hotel. One manufacturing enterprise. One industrial enterprise. Name one. None. Well, how do you get an economy to grow if that's not happening? How do you get a people to prosper if that's not happening? It can't happen. It cannot happen. No Bahamian has done it, and no foreigner has done it. So all the Bahamians who shout that We don't need the foreigners. Okay, well, the foreigners weren't doing anything in Freeport, so where are the Bahamians? Where your big investments? Xanadu sitting up there, dilapidated. Where are the Bahamians to go buy it and develop it? The Princess property is sitting there, dilapidated. Where are the Bahamians to go buy it and develop it? The International Bazaar sitting down there, dilapidated. Where are the Bahamians to go invest in it? Where are we? Who's stopping us? We don't need the foreigners. They're the ones who put the container port in there. Thank God it's there now, creating employment opportunities, business opportunities for others. There's a shipyard, foreigners, Bradford Marine, foreigners, Buckeye, foreigners, Pharmachem, foreigners. Where are the Bahamians? Where are we? Not who are we, but where are we? We're not there. We're not doing anything. And so since no new foreigners come in to invest, and no Bahamian has been a substantial investor ever, the place is stagnant. It's as simple as that. And it will continue to be stagnant so long as that persists. This isn't a question of the government of the Bahamas. If the government of the Bahamas could and knew how to move Freeport's economy forward, it would go and get investors, Bahamian or foreign, to come and move investments in the place. If it knew how. If it could do so. Has not happened. If the Grand Bahama Port Authority knew how to do it and could do it, it would do so. Have not. Or I have been hearing for almost 4+ years from the Grand Bahama Port Authority, insiders and outsiders. Oh, there's lots on the pipeline, in the pipeline, lots in the pipeline, lots in the pipeline, lots in the pipeline. You know what happens to that stays in a pipeline? You know what happens to the plumbing? It backs right up. What happened? What's the problem? What's going on? Now, I don't blame the Port Authority for that. I don't. I don't blame the government for that. I don't. The only thing I blame them for is these empty promises. Why you were talking in the first instance if you the thing wasn't sure? That's what I blame them for, because ultimately, investors are the ones who make things happen. Investors, what does the government do? Approve. What does the port do? Approve. You could be slow in approving, you could be fast in approving. But the investor is the one who plows his or her monies into a thing and generates economic activity. So my conclusion has to be that those investors, saving and except for Carnival, which is now moving, seeming to move forward with this project, that those investors who the government thought, I mean the port thought, it had in hand, or the government thought it had in hand, they either weren't or decided it wasn't an attractive enough proposition to proceed. And until that changes, nothing will change. We'll be right here beating up our gums over whether it's the government or the port. 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 The government of the port. We need to stop rowing. And find the kind of investors, you notice what I said, investors, Bahamian or foreign, whose appetite, capacity, and ability can get it done. You could try and find them. Maybe they'll find you, but you could try and find them. So let's talk about who ain't doing this and who ain't doing that. And the next one, you blame Michael Pintard, you blame Brave Davis. That's not hardly the issue. Hardly. And it is unfortunate if they are blaming each other. It's hardly the issue. Investments happen because investors decide there's money to be made here and I want to make that money. And those investors will invest in Russia, will invest in China, will invest in sub-Saharan Africa, will invest in Cuba, they'll invest in some of the most challenging places to invest on planet Earth if they believe the returns exist for them. So what I see is the kinds of people we may have had taken interest in us simply ain't motivated enough by the returns that they can get, or we have not found investors who can see this place as the kind of place to help them make the kind of monies that will dig them in. And so let's stop fooling ourselves. Let's stop being distracted. That's what happens. We get it distracted. Everything is political. Yeah, we could make it so. But life is, ask yourself, you got a couple of dollars, why you ain't doing nothing? Why you ain't investing? You ain't doing nothing? There are banks who are putting a little bit of money in Freeport. They're doing what they do. They got businesses in Freeport. I salute them. They ain't talking. But unfortunately, they can't scale up to the place where lots of these young people and lots of other people who are so desperately desirous of the ability to earn income can be engaged and earn that income. There's not that scaling up sufficiently by these smaller, wonderful Bahamian entrepreneurs and some foreign entrepreneurs. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand.
Cleveland Clinic's world-class care is here for you. From Ohio to Florida to London, Cleveland Clinic treats thousands of patients every year, ranked number 2 in the world by Newsweek. You can trust our caregivers to enhance your experience across each step of your treatment journey. For every care in the world, learn more at clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
Being an investor has its benefits. Like the margin loan facility at RF. I can use my government bonds, company shares, and other investments to access cash when I need it. At a low interest rate of 7.5%, flexible repayment terms, and a 48-hour approval time, I can easily get the cash I need for travel, home renovations, or to purchase additional shares. This is just one of the ways RF keeps my money working for me. Learn more about the RF margin loan at rfgroup.com.
Okay, school bag. Books, pencils, uniform, oh Lord, and I gotta buy snacks too?
Just lay it on the line.
The Guardian Media Group and AML Foods want to help families back to school snackathons. What's a snackathon? Well, we want to help by assisting in donating school snacks to children that may need them as they head back to school this year. To be a part of our snackathon, all you have to do is shop at your favorite Solomon Superstore or Fresh Market. At the store, you can donate your pre-existing loyalty points, or you can donate cash directly at the register. Every single penny will go towards purchasing snacks that will be donated for distribution by the Bahamas Feeding Network and Hands for Hunger. Together, we can ensure that every child that opens their backpack this year will have a snack and a smile.
Get involved, get involved.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together on whatever weather, cold or warm.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo, I'm your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 4393043. This text says, like you, I'd long been bullish on Grand Bahama's economic prospects. But I'm more nervous about Grand Bahama now, given what appears to be that island's particular susceptibility to the negative impacts of climate change. Yes, our archipelago on the whole shares at risk, but the impacts on Grand Bahama now seem particularly severe. I don't know why you would say that, actually. Grand Bahama had Francis and Jane in 2006. What happened after that? They went on for 10 or so years and then had Dorian. But how is that a trend that makes it especially susceptible? That has always been the case. It's been in a hurricane zone. I don't think that that's the issue at all for Grand Bahama. So I don't think so. I don't think that is keeping anybody away from investing in Grand Bahama. Like I tell you, you know, the principal reason investors still invest, the principal reason is to make returns. And if the returns are significant enough, they weigh the risk, and then the returns, if the returns are comparable, they invest. It's Texas Laing, you 138% correct about Grand Bahama. It's the best place to build opportunities. The Ingram administration bombed Freeport after that. Was it so sad? Why other governments don't do the same and stop not holding the port responsible? I think this notion of holding the port authority responsible is a farce. I mean, it's a farce. Honestly, it's a farce. Because, well, let's put it like this. To the extent that the port isn't doing a job it's supposed to do, which job is what? What's the port's job? What's the obligation that the port has? Maintain the place, blah, 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 and blah. The Port Authority is supposed to be a business. It's not a government entity. It's supposed to be a business. If you have a business, and your business ain't really making a buggy load of money, and you sit down and you okay with that, or you are not capable of making your business make more money, like, I could be disappointed in you, but it's your business. It's your business. Right? It's your business. If I am able to do something that causes your business to get more business, so I am able to go out there and round up customers and say, you know, they have a good product. They have some good stuff. And they come and patronize you, and your business grows, not because of what you did, but because of what I did, and then your employees benefit from it. Well, so what? Okay. So let's say the Port Authority is sitting on its backside and not doing anything to cause Freeport, Grand Bahama's economy to grow. Mind you, they're still maintaining the place. It's a cleaner, more organized place than any place in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas managed by the government of the Bahamas. Today, it is a better quality of life to live as a general community than any place in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas managed by the government of the Bahamas. You can't call Albany. Albany isn't managed by the government of the Bahamas, as an example. Nor is Lifeway Key. Right? So in terms of maintaining an environment of a place where your garbage gets picked up on time, where your streets are kept clean and all that kind of stuff, it does a better job. Even if it doesn't do a perfect job, it does a better job than any place the government of the Bahamas does. Any place. Okay. But if the government of the Bahamas has the wherewithal to cause investors to come and invest in free, but the only thing that's required by the Port Authority is to license the people. That's it. The port doesn't even have to be a partner with the people. Just license the people. Because the government say, listen, I got some people for you. When the container port came here, when Ingram went around the world and promoted the place, and there was interest by Hutchison and those, all the port had to do was license the people. They partnered with them, but they licensed the people. That's all that has to happen. So you explain to me. Why you blame the port if the government of the Bahamas, Ingram, Christie, Minnis, Davis, if the government of the Bahamas could scour the world Find interested parties in Freeport. I need you to go invest in that place. Let's take a tour. Let's look around. Isn't Carnival here? Isn't Containerport here? Isn't Buckeye here? Isn't PharmaChem here? Isn't the shipyard here? Isn't Bradford Marine here? How did that happen? How did that happen with those crazy people in the Port Authority? How did that happen? They licensed the people. Isn't Polymers here? Polymers International, been here for years and years. Doesn't Celebration bring its cruises here? Doesn't the Valeria? I mean, seriously, if you're the government of the Bahamas and you can get Saudi Arabians to come and you can get the people from Dubai to come, and you can get people from England to come, and you can get people from this place and the next. What's the problem? Why are you blaming the port? Yes, after you're done, you can say, y'all are lousy, we did this, we bought all these, but that's not happening either. So what is the point? We are wasting our breath with this argument of, oh, it's the port and the port and the port. It's a delusion. It's a delusion, right? Because it doesn't make sense. If you are the port owners and you're content to just collect fees, because that's your business model, you can collect fees, you're not going to get any new businesses, so generate more and expand your capital and all that kind of stuff. If that's how you're going to run your business, and so be it. You have a contractual agreement. If the government of the Bahamas has the brass to go and end the contractual obligation and to suffer whatever financial penalties might come as a consequence of doing so, then let it go and do so and stop beating up our jaw. We don't have to beat up our jaw. Just go do what you need to do. Tell them, listen, man, I don't like your business model. I don't like that you're just sitting down here collecting fees and not growing the place and all that kind of stuff. So therefore, I am going to rescind this contract. By law, I'm going to do so. It is assessed that we ought to pay. But it's a contractual obligation, and that is real. Listen, the only beneficiaries of a row between the board are the politics that gets massaged by row in the port. That's all. That's the only thing that happens. The port authority is like the Haitians, is like the banks. You cannot lose politically by rowing them. You cannot. But rowing them changes absolutely nothing. How long have they rowed the banks? Anything changed with the fees? How long have they been, we've been beating up our jaws about the Haitians, and the Haitians are still coming because Haiti is still in a mess? How long have you been rowing the Port Authority? From when I was a child, the Port Authority was being rowed. People disliked the heads of the Port Authority. And from when I was a child, I'm 55 years old now. I was 10 years old when that was happening. Then 40 years later, why? Because it don't change nothing. All that happens is somebody gets to get stimulated by the fact that somebody rowed the port. Rowed the port? You're not holding the port accountable for a row in the port. For calling the port out. If nothing changes, how is that holding them accountable? If nothing changes. If it's that bad, go to Parliament. Rescind the Oxford Creek Agreement. That's the only thing that would change it. And then replace them with who? Yourselves or with new owners. Okay. But that's what real change. Yeah, you can look tough round the board. Ingram rowed the port. But he didn't do it outside. You know, Ingram rowed the port inside. That's how come in the course of doing some things, you got the two high schools and some other things for Grand Bahama. Yeah. Ingram row the port. Didn't do it publicly. Ingram and the port row plenty. But it was a row in respect of negotiations to get some things done. When the port needed the government to do some things. I hear people say, oh, the FNM and the PLP extended the Oxford Creek Agreement. Really? We could talk about that when we come back. What that exactly meant, because some of you talk about it again, but I'm afraid you don't understand it. You don't really understand what happened. So maybe we could help when we come back. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back.
I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Everywhere. Fishermen here and there. The Ministry of Agriculture, Marine Resources, and Family Island Affairs now has 30 services available online. Apply for your agriculture farmland lease, farmers registration and license, and crawfish trapping permits online. All kinds of duty-free and import permits are now just a click away. Visit mygateway.gov.bs and grow your business today. My Gateway, making government work for you.
It's back to school season again. Send your kids off with everything they need, from books, uniforms, to school supplies, all with a Fidelity personal loan. Apply today for a chance to win amazing back to school prizes. Call 823-4374.
This is Guardian Radio, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796, that's 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. All right, so we were talking about Grand Bahama, and its Freeport in particular, the Port Authority. We have a text here, says, speak it, we are the way forward, I believe that. That Grand Bahama is certainly a great option for moving things forward if we can find, attract, mobilize the appropriate capital to do so. So every time Grand Bahama Port Authority comes up, someone gets on the air and says, oh, the FNM agreement, and then somebody rightly comes back and says, yeah, but it was the PLP who formed a committee headed by Marcus Bethel, Dr. Marcus Bethel, and they recommended the extension of the Hawksville Creek Agreement and blah, 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 blah. Let me say, I'm going to be slow and dispassionate about it. The Hawksville Creek Agreement is a 99-year agreement signed in the 1950s, I believe it was. Okay, it is a 99-year agreement, almost 100 years. Okay, Which means then that if you signed something in 1955 that has a 99-year life, that means that the thing will end in 2054. Can I say this again slowly? If you signed something in 1955, there was not an independent government of the Bahamas then. The Bahamas was still a colony of Great Britain. So it was the British government that signed this agreement with the principals of the Port Authority. It was a 99-year agreement, and it therefore means that it ends in 2054. If the Ingram administration does something in respect of the Hawkesbury Creek Agreement in the 2000s, how do you extend something that didn't need to be extended? Because it's got a 99-year life and it had some 50-plus years left in it. How is it that you could say, well, they extended the agreement? You can't, because it's wrong. And then if the Christie administration in 2015, 2016 does something, how could you say it extended an agreement whose life goes to 2054? The life is 2054. It doesn't end until 2054. Okay. So, Mr. Laing, what did happen? Okay. There were elements, there was a component of the Hawkesbury Creek Agreement that sunsetted in 2010. What component was that? It was a component that gave the licensees of the port the right not to pay the government business license fees and not to pay the government real property taxes. Can I say it again? What expired? The portion of the agreement that exempted the licensees from paying business license fees and paying real property taxes. Well, when the Hawkesbury Creek Agreement was written and as it evolved, the vast majority of the licensees of the port, 80%+ of them, were foreigners. They were non-Mainians. In 2010, 80% of the licensees of the port were Bahamians, which meant that those Bahamian licensees have to pay business license fees to the Port Authority and business license fees to the government, or pay business license fees to the government. It also meant that they would have to pay service charges to the port and real property taxes to the government, own properties, the Bahamians. So the government of the Bahamas, which I was a member of, said, is that what we want to do to struggling Bahamians in Freeport and cause them to be in perhaps a double jeopardy situation? License to the port, license to the government, real property tax to the port, to the government, service charges to the port. And the government made the decision, no, we won't do that. But to extend this provision, this, not the Hawkesbury Creek Agreement, its life was 2000 to 2054. To extend this provision, negotiated with Edwards and George and them, okay, you got to give me this, got to give me that, got to build that, got to build that, build the stadium, the Grandmama Sports Complex, all that kind of stuff. That was what happened. And what did Mr. Christie do? And that extension was for 15 years, I think it was. So that when Mr. Christie came up, when it expired, and Mr. Christie was in office, he now was confronted with the same reality. Do you want to cause Bahamians to have to pay the port licensees, license fees, and the government business license fees, real property taxes to the government, and service charges to the port? And the Christie administration, afraid
of the pending the Hawkesville Creek Agreement, set up a committee to look at the matter and to do what? Come to the same conclusion Ingram came to. Extend the thing. And what did they get out of it? What? Nothing new. There was never an extension of the Oxford Creek Agreement because the Oxford Creek Agreement goes to 2054. There was an extension. There was a key. Actually, it wasn't even an extension. What the government did was pass what we call the Grand Bahama Development Act. And in that act, that wasn't an agreement between the government and the port. It was an act that simply kept in place the exemption from paying business license fees and real property taxes to those people who dwelt in the Freeport area. That's all that happened. And I know I'm going to say this, and I know that somebody's going to get up on these talk shows and say the very same thing again. This Texas, Mr. Laing, the press may be to blame. The newspaper headline said Oxford Creek Agreement extended. I think that's all some people remember. That is true. You are absolutely right. You are absolutely right, because they are, the media sometimes does that and picks it up that way and says it the same way too, and it is wrong. It is incorrect. Absolutely incorrect. The Oxford Creek Agreement is a 99-year agreement signed in 2055, expires in 2054. It had some provisions that expired around 2010, etc., and the government did not extend them to the extent of having some new agreement with the Port Authority. It's an act, and then that act exempted Bahamians and Freeport from paying those licenses and real property taxes as they had been enjoying under the Hawkesville Creek Agreement. And I'll say this, as I have said it today, and still somebody can say, was the FNM that extended the Hawkesville Creek Agreement, and then Mr. Christie them extended the Hawkesville Creek Agreement, and they will not pay attention to the very simple fact that the agreement itself, drafted, signed on August 4th, 1955, was a 99-year agreement. 99 years. 99. That agreement still has, how much years left? Right? How much layers does it have left? It got 31 years left. That agreement. And not because Mr. Ingram them extended it, not because Mr. Christie them extended it, because that's the life of it. Right? Just started. I see, Alan, I was talking about you a little earlier and commending you for your better understanding of the situation in Grand Bahama than plenty I listen to. All right, so let's stop saying that the Ingram administration or the Christie administration extended the Oxford Creek Agreement. It's a lie. Extended were provisions that benefited predominantly Bahamians, because predominantly Bahamians are the licensees of the Port Authority now. Predominantly. They're the ones who benefit from not having to pay double jeopardy of business license fees to the port, service charges to the port, and real property taxes to the government. That's so do you want the government to end that? Those of you who are in Freeport who live there, do you want the government to end the fact that you only pay service charges to the port and not pay real property taxes at the moment? Do you want it ended? So that you could tell the port, we don't want nothing to do with y'all. I don't think so. I don't think so. It's a great show as usual, Mr. Laing. You could imagine if marriage had an Oxford Creek agreement attached to it. On the line, go ahead, Colin, we're listening to you.
Hi, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. How are you doing?
Hey, I'm right here, man. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good, man. Listen, I am so happy that you finally cleared that Hawksville Creek agreement debacle up, because every time it goes to election, there's always a call. They have to make an extended agreement. And I tell you from today, I know the full story.
Yeah.
But here's my question. Mm-hmm. If you said that the agreement was signed in 1955, I think you said, right?
Yes, in 1955.
Yes, which was before the independent government.
Yes,
why wasn't the agreement voided or restructured under a new government, like our independent government? I'm just asking, because a lot of things we got rid of once we became independent. So why was that agreement set in stone that we could not remove that agreement, or a new party sit to the table, come up with a new agreement or something like that? I'll hang up and listen.
Okay, no problem. Good question. No, it can't. You can't, because the agreement was between the government of the Bahamas. It didn't say whether it was an independent government or another. The agreement was between the government of the Bahamas and the Grand Bahama Port Authority and the successors to the government of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, whether it was dependent or independent, was the same government. So that's why you ever hear people say governments don't change, administrations change. Right? So it wasn't predicated on there being an independent government and a non-independent government. The government of the Bahamas that signed it at the time was the British government that had responsibility for the territory. And when the government of the Bahamas, when the Bahamas became independent, that was in place. So the government of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas never changed. Right? It's just for the government. That's why they didn't say the Ingram administration, the Finland administration, the British administration. They said the government of the Bahamas. So the government never changed. So the contractual obligations fell to the government of the Bahamas and continued to the government of the Bahamas. There's no way to get out of that other than the two parties deciding to do so. We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Mr. Laing, good afternoon. How are you today?
Hey, I'm okay, man. How are you?
Excellent show as usual, man. I'm glad you're touching this today, and I'm pleased that you're clearing this up, because there are a lot of people who have a misconception about the Hawksville Creek Agreement.
Yeah.
There are some who haven't read the document, who don't understand the document, or who just don't care to understand the document and just want to play politics with the document.
Because if
you're familiar with the document, the government nor the Port Authority can make any changes, deletion, or amendments without permission or without the consent of both parties. It can't be a one-sided agreement.
Actually, it's a three-sided affair. It's the port, the government, and the licensees.
You know, in regards to Fred Mitchell's statement, I think Fred Mitchell was disingenuous with the statement he made that the Port Authority came to the government begging. I think that was really disingenuous on his part, and that statement was out of order, because he knows better, because he was a part of the cabinet at the time when the extension was made.
What extension was made?
For the incentive for the real property tax in the industrial sector for
Grand Bahama. Yes, exactly. I just wanted to make sure you said it so people could pick it up.
Yeah. You know, because people are of the impression that Hubert Ingram extended the document, extend the Hawksville Creek Agreement. People are of the impression that Perry Christie extended the Hawksville Creek Agreement, where there was only part of the document
and a small part that really impacted and influenced mostly Bahamians today.
You know, and the licensees in Grand Bahama, and the people in Grand Bahama, particularly, especially the ones who pay licensees and service charge. We pretty much understand the Hawksville Creek Agreement, for me personally, I believe if the government was to buy the Hawksville Creek by the Port Authority, I would park up and leave the island.
But let's be honest now. You live in Grand Bahama, right?
Yes.
The thing that's frustrating Bahamians in Grand Bahama is that the economy is not prospering. Right? So everything has to be tougher because the economy isn't prospering. And so they want prosperity.
That's what they want. That's the frustration. Do you complain about how clean your environment is in Freeport?
No, I don't complain. As a matter of fact, twice a week, on Wednesdays and Saturdays, about 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, my garbage gets picked up without question.
Tuesdays and Thursdays for me.
Every other week, the lawnmower to my corner cutting the grass.
And the big lift comes and moves stuff off the side of the road if you dump it on the side of the road to be moved.
Yeah, exactly. So, me personally, I have no complaints with, I mean, the service charges might be kind of high, but look what I get in return for my service charge. Mm-hmm. I don't have to worry about maggots and rodents in my yard or rodents in my neighborhood because my garbage is being picked up. My roads are fixed and my curves are maintained.
It's really the economy, and if you're working and if you have a reasonable job in Grand Bahama, honestly, it is a fantastic place to live because you're not feeling that hardship of not having income and what have you. And yes, the cost of living, the price of things like food and food stuff, it's that a little rough though.
Yeah, you know, and another point too with regards to the Hawksburg to the Port Authority, you know. Let's look at the industrial sector in Grand Bahama, which is booming. The industrial sector for the last couple of years has been carrying Grand Bahama.
Yes, absolutely.
So if you take away the industrial sector, which the government has no responsibility for, the government don't know how hard for these industrial companies get here. You know what I mean? So, you know.
The government knows. The government knows, maybe not the administration, because Hubert Alexander Ingram knows, because most of them came under his tenure.
Yeah, let's look at the container port. Let's look at Bradford Marine. Let's look at the shipyard.
Yeah.
They came under Hubert Ingram.
Even Buckeye was sold under Ingram. Buckeye was sold for $1.3 billion, and Ingram sent me inside the meeting and told me, go get me my tax money.
Yeah. And, you know, and let me ask you a question. The government owns about 7% shares in the Port Authority. What happened to that
shell? That's a myth.
That's not factual.
No, that's a myth. Now, I'm not saying that at one point the government didn't own some shares, but the government does not now own a share. And the only way for you to not own something is for it to have been disposed of. Now, the better question for you is, how was it disposed of?
That's
the million-dollar question, Mr. Lyon. That's the million-dollar question. It does not now own it. That's not in dispute. It used to own the shares. And if you dispose of something, especially if it's an exchange for value, all you have to do now is ask the question, when the 7% came back to the port, where did the value for that 7% go? That's the question.
You know, and if Mr. Fred Mitchell is listening, please stop fighting with a private company in the public domain, man. Meet with the Port Authority, sit around the round table, and see what y'all could work out for the people in Grand Bahama. This back and forth pettiness, this ain't serving nobody no good. Nobody. In particular, right, in Grand Bahama.
All right, my brother. Thank you very much for calling. Appreciate it. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break and pay our respects to our wonderful sponsors. When we come back, we'll continue our discussion. We'll be back after this break.
Take a stand, everybody.
Marsha got the lady run into me, Marsha got.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Being an investor has its benefits. Like the margin loan facility at RF. I can use my government bonds, company shares, and other investments to access cash when I need it. At a low interest rate of 7.5%, flexible repayment terms, and a 48-hour approval time, I can easily get the cash I need for travel, home renovations, or to purchase additional shares. This is just one of the ways RF keeps my money working for me. Learn more about the RF margin loan at rfgroup.com. Zhivargo.com.
Okay, school bag, books, pencils, uniform. Oh, Lord. And I gotta buy snacks, too?
Just lay it on the line.
The Guardian Media Group and AML Foods want to help families in need with our first ever back-to-school snackathon. What's a snackathon? Well, we want to help by assisting in donating school snacks to children that may need them as they head back to school this year. To be a part of our snackathon, all you have to do is shop at your favorite Solomon Superstore or Fresh Market. At the store, you can donate your pre-existing loyalty points, or you can donate cash directly at the register. Every single penny will go towards purchasing snacks that will be donated for distribution by the Bahamas Feeding Network and Hands for Hunger. Together, we can ensure that folks here will have a snack and a smile.
Get involved, get involved.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. It cleared up some now. It's cleared up. Look like they're so threatening right now. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316. Or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. This text says, it is very strange for me to hear you say a lot of people have a lot to say about Grandmama Port Authority, and Seattle Johnson is one who is making or made the most sense. Can't remember if that's your words verbatim, but if I find that strange, I wonder why he is the only one. Just my wondering, first of all, you have to listen to me carefully. I didn't say he was making sense about the Grand Bahama Port Authority. I didn't say that at all. I said he talks about Grand Bahama, and it seems to have the most accurate awareness of what has happened in Grand Bahama, especially in regards to the economy. That's what I said. All right? And why is that? Because some people were talking about Grand Bahama's economy, and C. Allen Johnson was able to weigh in on, historically speaking, about the investments that took place in Grand Bahama and a number of developments that took place in Grand Bahama that impacted upon the economic circumstances of Grand Bahama. He was able to correct people about the port, the so-called extension of the Hawkesbury Creek Agreement and so forth. That's why. And I didn't say he's the only one. He says he's one of the ones I heard. Okay? We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hey, Mr. Laing. How you doing?
Hey, I'm right here, man. How are you?
Yeah. You know, I have one of your book. It's called, The Counting?
Yeah, Who Moves My Conk, yeah.
Yeah, my wife, and she brought that home.
Really?
Yes.
It sold some places. It sold some places.
Yes, right.
I haven't done a reprint of it, but I'm doing an update of it. I'm doing a second edition of it.
Okay. Thanks for that. She's Canadian, but she passed. Yeah.
Oh wow. Okay. So sorry to hear that, man. So sorry.
Yeah, but one thing I have to say is that, see, I'm a former police officer, and back in the day, like in the 70s and 80s, the guys, the guys that trained in the police force, they said, "Oh, you guys are so poor up here in Nassau." So where all of that gone then?
So that's what they used to say in Freeport?
No. When the guys used to come up here, you know, when the oil thing was going down in Grand Bahama, you know, people, those guys were big time down in Grand Bahama. But, you know, I can find, you know, I know where all of that went, you know, because...
Yeah. Well, I mean, there was a period of time in Grand Bahama where lots of drug money was flowing. That's a fact. It was flowing. People were spending big money. Listen, I remember some Christmases. Guys were walking inside jewelry stores buying $30,000 Rolex watches in cash. That's for sure.
Guys come down from Grand Bahama and said, "Man, be sent to Nassau, you know, to for Boca Kentucky, you know, Boca de Kentucky."
My fellas would hop on a plane, charter flight, and fly a plane to Florida, have lunch, dinner, and come back the same day.
Okay, nice talking to you, sir.
Yeah, man. Thank you, my friend.
All right.
This text says, "Good day, Zhivargo. Listening attentively to your informative show. Is it today that you have the budget zone meeting? If so, kindly send a link." Yes, the budget zone meeting is today at 7 p.m. So if you're interested in joining us, you have to send me a text and I will send you the link so that you could join us and we'll walk you through online the budget of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, so that the next time this comes around, you could go and look at the document for yourself and see for yourself what is going on, so that you don't have people saying that, oh, the government isn't, don't let you know where it's spending your money and how it's spending your money. Yes, it does. It does write in the budget, both in terms of what was spent and in terms of what it proposes to spend. So you can get that. You can get that if you let us know. If you let me know that you want to join. It says, "Great show. First Grand Bahama brags about cable. Now you are garbage. Get pick up twice a week, boy. I tell you, you are good show." You have a call on the line, boy. I call him listening to you.
Mr. Laing, how you doing?
Hey, what's up, Mr. Allen, man? You had a fellow,
yeah. Well, you know, see, one of the problems I have is I go and took the time to read the documents, read the laws that was passed, and actually try to understand the environment for which I...
And that would certainly mess you up, wouldn't it?
Yeah. But I've told people anytime they want to, just send me a WhatsApp at 825-9700. I'll send them the Royal Commission report. I'll send them each of the agreements, the ones that first did by Ingram and the one did by the PLP administration. Now, when you ask about that, right, the question is not whether or not it was wrong or right, because you can't unring the bell. What you do have to ask, though, did you get value for money? And I said to them, there's about 4,000 licensees, of which 3,000 of those are behemoths. Just ask them if they benefited from whatever it is at that time, when it was passed. And overwhelmingly, they would tell you yes. It would have, if retroactively, if that was being applied to them, it would have been catastrophic to many of the businesses on Grand Bahama that even exist today would have gone under. But
the benefit in that particular provision was clear.
Yes, and so, you know, but just. Let me make one point, and I hear people say the government and the Port Authority need to sit down. This is a tripart agreement. The government, the Port Authority, and the licensees must sit down. And what people have to understand is the Hoxie Creek Agreement is a law. And any modification of that agreement requires the government, the Port Authority, and 80% of the licensees to come into agreement. And so that agreement is there until 2054. The problem with people have, and I think, believe it or not, I would be very interested in reading your next book in light of the changes that has happened. The Hoxha Kikusif that was then and is now, that is the model. And if we understand these economic zones in the Bahamas, we'll be looking to create some more the same way Dominican Republic and others do in light of the so-called, we don't have the WTO conversation anymore because, you know, in the proper context, but these economic zones is powerful. The Hawksville Creek Agreement, and the most powerful thing I took from your conversation right now is like you went center on the head of the nail. We're missing the argument in this conversation. This argument in this conversation is about economics. Where Grand Bahama is and where Grand Bahama is going to go. I use the expression, what's now, what's new, and what's next? And that is the conversation that's not coming out of the Port Authority or out of government.
But on C. Allen, even more fundamental to that is, and you're right, where is it now, where is it going, et cetera, but how is it going to get there? And the how isn't a political dominant question. The how is a private enterprise dominant question.
There you go. And this is why I said more so. I think the license is in the Port Authority station as where to go and have government adjust its policies and legislation that is needed for it to succeed.
Fitzy Allen, let's pause for a minute now. to get a wonderful hotel in the Freeport, what new policy needs to happen? I'm just asking that one, right? To get a huge digital enterprise in Ground and Freeport, what new something has to happen? To get a big manufacturing enterprise in Freeport, what needs to change?
Yes, right. And that's the conversation we're not having, because like when you talk about, when the government loves to talk about these new economic models, and I mean, I just talk about them so much, I didn't memorize them. Digital economy, conceptual economy, knowledge economy, aquamarine economy, carbon economy, green economy, blue economy, ocean economy, orange economy, data economy, platform economy, shared economy, silver economy, circular economy, climate economy, crypto economy, AI economy. I hope I didn't miss any. And so all of these things are possible, but no one is asking, what is the adjustments that has to be made? So when you look at all those economic models, I talk about the fintech, the regtech, suptech, proptech, insurtech, tradefi, agrotech, there's about 30 laws that just need some finessing or creation. But they're not having that conversation to actually make it happen. And so it's almost as if though...
But you can have that conversation with yourself. That's like me having a conversation with myself about what a gastroenterologist needs to practice his practice. I don't know anything about gastroenterology. Have that conversation with a gastroenterologist.
Yes. And so if we don't have supposedly the intellectual, the 100% of the intellectual capital for any of these, then again, the conversation has to be broader than the government is having. Because let me say something. I am one to believe not only that the Hawksville Creek Agreement should remain, I'm one to believe that we should be having conversation on whether we should extend it for maybe another 50 years with some nice reforms, because it's that important in the 21st century. But just like you say, we have, because even though you say 31 years is not a long time from a perspective of businesses, especially if you're going to come here and build a data center. Or you're going to come here and insert yourself in these new AI economy that will take about 10 to 15 years to mature, the data economy. So you're not going to come and say, okay, God, I'm going to build here for 15 years. I need to be around for about 30 to 40 years. And then 14 years after that, I'm going to have to decide what I'm going to do. I'm building almost a $1 billion building. So, if we just remove the politics out of it and have a sensible conversation, because everyone knows from going, when the first time I heard Hubert Alexander Ingram said it in 2002, the Grand Bahama, and I think he was coming out of the 9/11, you know, the 9/11 era with the impact on tourism. And he was saying that, look, we have to reboot this Grand Bahama economy because it's going to be part of a strong part of the redefining of the Bahamian economy. And then it was repeated again in 2007, then again in 2012, 2017, and again in 2021. But again, it seems as if, this is my personal opinion, this government is devoid of where to proceed next on Grand Bahama, and this argument is about substance. And
Thank you, my friend. Appreciate you calling. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our final break. When we come back, we'll continue our discussion. We'll be back after this break. You're listening to Z Live.
Take a stand, everybody, come take my hand.
Burger King.
King wants you to enjoy a classic sandwich so good we've been making it since 1979. Introducing the original chicken sandwich, American style, with fries and a drink for only $7.95, including VAT. This sandwich is made with white meat chicken, lightly breaded and topped with crisp, fresh lettuce, creamy mayonnaise, tomatoes, and lots of American cheese on a long sesame seed bun. Get your American original chicken sandwich combo for only $7.95, including VAT, at Burger King NASA, where taste is king.
Too many debt bills? Overdue on loan payments? Improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Shrink your debt payments with a debt consolidation loan and built-in savings that pays you 5% interest. Call 356-7764.
Wait, you know what's going down tomorrow?
Nobody, what happening?
Joe bringing the knife to school? He could do Junior in?
For what?
Wait, he fooled with Joe girl?
Mother sick. And you know Junior don't bark down for nothing. So that means he got a big fight tomorrow.
So whose side you want?
Side? I trying to stay in school, not Simpson fan. We gotta tell somebody about this fight.
Tell somebody? I ain't no snitch. I mean cool, you know.
Wait, if you so cool, then you need to stay in school and stay out of the fight.
Yeah, but if I don't hang on Joe's side, him and he boys coming for me next.
All right, so we definitely gotta tell somebody. We gotta prevent the fight.
What I say, I don't want nobody call me snitch.
We could just call Crime Stoppers. You could report what you know. And all you gotta do is call them or you text them through the Crack Crime Bahamas app and nobody can know it's you.
Then the police come looking for me for more info, and when they finish with them, Joe them coming looking for me?
When you call Crime Stoppers, the calls go directly to Miami and they don't ask nothing about you. Then you can get the pen from them and they can claim a reward later using that same pen.
Plus, everything's scrambled so nobody can read what you said.
Calls 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Yes.
Hi, how you doing?
Hi, how you doing?
Good.
Yeah, I'm calling to touch bases on the issues with the government taking position in favor of foreigners over Bahamians. You brought up the situation with you all giving the Bahamians the breaks with tax exemptions when you were in the administration.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, because I have a situation where the Bahamas Investment Authority will not answer my letter in reference to Pittstown Point Landing Development in Crooked Island on private property that I own. And there was a situation since January. They issued a letter of acknowledgement, and since that time, the director, Ms. Felicia Woods-Hanna, has refused to give me an updated status. Pittstown not meeting the standards according to the International Persons Land Holdings Act. You are familiar with that law, right?
I am. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, they never got any approvals, and the matter's been going on for 22 years.
They didn't get approval to purchase the property?
They ain't got approval for none of the 14 properties. And there is a letter that I wrote in November because
Listen. What you are getting into is a little bit more nuanced and is appropriate for the radio. Can you take my number and give me a call when you're done?
Your phone number?
Yeah, 439.
439.
3043.
3043.
Yeah, I'd like to. I'd like to understand better and see what's going on. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, we'll talk then.
All right.
All right. All right. Yeah. Somebody asked. Let me see here. Let me read this text. Yes, says, good day, Mr. Laing. Interesting show. Several years back, I was attending an event in Grand Bahama and observed how slow things were. I wondered how people make it. For example, the taxi drivers play dominoes from morning till night. Question I'd like to ask is, how is the economy of Freeport now? Okay. So, this is always an interesting question. The economy of Freeport as a whole is not well. Why do I say as a whole? Because there are people in Freeport who are doing quite well. Their economy is great, right? They may work for the port, they may work for the shipyard, they may work for the container port, etc. Their economy is fine, right? But as a whole, there are far too many people in Grand Bahama who are looking for work but cannot find work, who are discouraged because they cannot find work. Young people who, in the significant numbers, who cannot find work. There are too many people who have had to leave the island in order to find work. So when it's like that, that means the economy is seeing the needs of the people of the economy. But that is not to say that there aren't people and parts of the economy where people can say, you know, I'm doing relatively well, and, you know, I love this place, I'm living okay, and, you know, and then, of course, people will complain about the cost of food in the stores, isn't it? That ain't no joke. That ain't no joke. Things will be a little pricey. But of course, you have to then manage that by virtue of your own choices and whatever. So Freeport's economy as a whole is not sound. It's not good. Not far from what it needs to be and what we would like for it to be as a country, so that it can generate greater levels of business opportunity, employment, profitability, income, and the like. That's not happening yet. But while Nassau, New Providence, has a better economy, Nassau's economy, New Providence's economy, is still not where we would like it to be either. Far different than Freeport, mind you. Still. So as a whole, the Bahamian economy is not doing well, not as well as we would like it to be, right? It is recovered. It has recovered well from the pandemic, and it is in a shape that we should be pleased with, because it could be far worse, but it's still an economy not generating the levels of employment, the levels of profitability and prosperity that we need. And that's our challenge. That's to be able to do the kinds of things that can make that happen. Overall, though, the quality of in Freeport is dampened mostly by its economic misfortunes, not by its physical environment, not by its social environment. Its crime rate is not significant. You know, it's not overrun by negativity, but its economic situation puts a damper on the quality of life for far too many people. And because it's been so long, people have settled into a kind of fit with it. So they have become accustomed to making the adjustments necessary to survive in this kind of environment. But it is certainly not the environment that they had become accustomed to. I could tell you that I was just driving in Freeport, and I was looking at a neighborhood and looking at a commercial spot, and I said, wow, what a difference. What a difference. And that the issues are clear. Issues are very clear that things are not well. And what fixes that? Can I tell you again? What changes that? Can I tell you again? What changes that is some Bahamian investor or investors, some foreign investor or investors, with some idea to sell some product or to sell some service, predominantly to the world, not to Bahamians, but to the world, deciding, I think the best place for me to do what I seek to do is in Freeport or in Grand Bahama. And therefore, take the steps necessary to go ahead and get that license and put down that business and operate in Freeport. That is what does it. Because in the process of doing so, they will require goods and services. They will require construction services. They will require employees. They will require electrical services. They will require food services and all these kinds of things that will benefit from their having come in there. And if enough of them come in there, the economy grows and grows and grows, and now the people who are in the place, they have been sucked up in terms of employment, and so therefore others have to come in because they need more employees. And so the people who are in Nassau say, oh, you know, I could finally return home because there's an opportunity for me to return home. I could go and work, oh, I'm a hotel worker, but they got a new hotel and it's operating and it's really attracting good visitors and so forth and so forth. And boom, the next thing you know, the island is booming. Then if rich people from away in Europe and Asia and Latin America decide, I want a quieter place to live, a nice, clean, organized place to live, I'm going to go and buy a property and build a house or home, second, third home in Freeport or in Grand Bahama. And they're going to come and bring their money, and they're going to shop in your stores and go to your restaurants and use your transportation services and buy electrical services and so forth and so forth. And they are going to add to the economy, and boom, things are going to gain. That's what's going to take. Now, you tell me what row between the Port Authority and the government to fix that. Tell me. All the row between the two is hurt that. It's not going to fix that. It's not going to help that. It's going to hurt that. This Texas says the fight or the owner by the owners was also significant. Yes, you're right. That's just what I said. Fighting ain't going to fix it. Fighting to hurt the situation. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, listen, y'all have a great evening. God bless. So glad you could join us here today. And those of you who are going to join us tonight at 7 o'clock, I look forward to seeing you then. God bless, and we'll talk to you tomorrow. He spares life. You've been listening to Z-Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. Take care.
Live off the record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you by AML Foods Limited, Burger King, the Cleveland Clinic, the Digital Transformation Unit, Freeport News.